we go. In 3, 2, 1.
Wait. Hold on a sec. You need to know how we got here.
Hi, I'm Adam Lawson from the Ontario Science Center. Have you ever wanted to send a handwritten message to a friend? Maybe you could skip the post office and send it right over the fence. Now, you could give it to them personally, but I thought it'd be a lot more fun to build my very own homemade flying device. Besides, you could learn about air and the science of flight along the way. After a few attempts, this is the design I came up with, but let me show you my journey along the way.
My first attempt at making a glider wasn't as successful as I hoped it would be, but that's not a bad thing. Things rarely work out the first time you test them. Nevertheless, I was determined to make this work. I decided to ask some of my friends at the Science Center for advice. It's great to get a different perspective on things when you're trying to work out a problem. One of the things they suggested was that I should investigate what air is like, or, as scientists like to say, its properties. You can't expect to build something that moves through air without understanding air itself, right? After all, people have been exploring what air is all about for thousands of years. From the mythical Greek legend of Icarus, through the brilliant Muslim scholars of the Middle Ages, to Leonardo da Vinci in the 1400s. It took centuries to figure out how to build flying machines which kept people in the air, but eventually the Wright brothers figured it out in the year 1903.
My friends challenged me to think like these scientists and try out a few activities which demonstrate the properties of air.
I don't know about you, but I usually take air for granted. Just because it's invisible doesn't mean it's not there. It's all around us, but we hardly ever notice it. We can't see it or even taste it, but we can feel it. You probably notice this when wind is blowing on your face or when you're moving really fast. We can feel air because air is matter. And like all forms of matter, it takes up space, has mass, and can be compressed. I thought I'd start with the idea that air takes up space. It was simply a matter of inflating a balloon, and yep, the air from my lungs definitely makes it take up more space. Demonstrating that air has mass was a bit trickier. I used a kitchen scale, and as you can see, the inflated balloon weighs more than the empty balloon.
The next demonstration was my favorite. We now know that air takes up space and has mass, but what if you tried to squeeze it? Can you squeeze it? In other words, compress it.
I placed the balloon inside a bottle, with the top of the balloon stretched over the mouth of the bottle. Then, I try to inflate it. What do you think is going to happen? Make a prediction. Yeah, no, not happening. The air inside the bottle had nowhere to go and was pushing back against the balloon as I tried to inflate it. To get the balloon to blow up, I needed to give that air that was trapped inside the bottle a way to escape. So I made a little modification. What do you think I did? Let's see if you're right. I poked a hole in the bottle, so this time, when I inflated the balloon, the air in the bottle could escape out of the hole. And that way, there was room for the balloon to expand inside of the bottle. You could even hear the air rushing out of the hole as I inflated the balloon. I could even blow into the bottle and use the pressure of the air from my lungs to turn the balloon inside out. Pretty cool. When air is compressed or moving, it can generate pressure. Plus, as objects move through the air, they alter the pressure of the air around them. If the object has the right shape and moves at the right speed, it could lead to flight.
Another idea my friend suggested was to observe nature, just like the Wright brothers did over 100 years ago. They suggested I head outside with a notebook and record all the flying and gliding devices I see. And let me tell you, there sure were a lot.
I was impressed with the amount of flying objects I saw, but what really surprised me was their shapes. A lot of these objects were long and skinny, with two wings, which were flat and wide. That couldn't be a coincidence. Could these shapes be the key to flight? With all this newfound information, I decided to modify my glider with longer, flat wings. Do you think this change improved my glider? Let's see. Better. But not great. At this point, I knew I was making progress, but I thought I could do better. I decided to contact my friends at the Ontario Science Centre once again to see if they had any more advice to offer.
While you were out communing with nature, we decided to explore the forces of flight.
But not only that, we built machines to demonstrate those principles.
Adam, you inspired me to build a flying machine that stores its energy in an elastic and uses spinning wings to create lift, that upward force that's required for flight. Now, I'm still working on my model. I'm having problems with the angle that I need to make the wings. It's called the angle of attack. As I move forward, it'll push on the air and create that lifting force. But if it's too far, I just create a wall. Because my wings are spinning, I actually have to tilt them in opposite directions to get the maximum amount of lift so that I can overcome the weight of the machine and hopefully it'll fly through the air. Now, sadly, eventually it runs out of energy, which means it stops spinning, there's no more lift, and then you know it's going to happen. Yeah, it does not land with any grace.
That's great. I can see how lift is necessary to keep objects flying.
There's also thrust. So I built a bottle rocket launcher to explore that. Thrust is a force that helps things get off the ground or whatever they happen to be on and into the air. Now, real rockets need a huge amount of force to counter Earth's gravity. So they have really powerful engines, but I'm just launching a paper straw rocket. So I didn't need anything ground shaking. So I just built a launcher out of a plastic water bottle and a straw. Check it out. Now, you might notice I also added fins. So this is to counter the spinning of the rocket and help it aim straighter. And if they look familiar, that's no surprise because Indigenous people have known for centuries about fins, and they would add them to their arrows, usually in the form of feathers, to improve their aim.
That's really cool. Now I have an idea how to get my object into the air. But what about the landing?
It's all about drag. That's the force that pushes back on moving things. It's also known as resistance. The faster something moves, the more drag or resistance is created. Like holding your hand outside the window of a moving car. It's hard to keep it still. Or like the way water pushes against your body when you're in a swimming pool. These are just some cool ways you can experience drag. So I was thinking, how about using drag and gravity to slow down your machine, Adam? While thrust moves things forward, drag acts in the opposite direction of your flying device.
I decided to explore drag forces, so I have two parachutes that I designed, one with a larger canopy and one with a smaller canopy. Which one do you think is going to have more air resistance and more drag? Let's test it out. Whoa! Oh! Okay, but Mary, we better tell Adam what's at the end of that canopy.
There's an egg.
There's an egg, Adam. So hopefully if our canopy, our large canopy, gets enough air resistance, our egg will survive the drop. Okay, Mary, go for it. Oh, let's have a look. It survived!
I really like the idea of a parachute, but I'm not sure I could include that.
Well, there's more than one way you can use drag to slow down your glider, Adam. You could also adjust the angle of your wings. That's exactly how insects and birds slow down. They change the motion and angle of their wings.
That might just work. I'll have to give it a try.
So as you can tell, I've learned a lot about flight over the last week. I created a new glider based on what I've learned, and I'm ready to test it out. Let's see if I can get this message over the fence. Here we go. In 3, 2, 1.
Ow! Whose idea was it to throw a glider over the fence? Look, a message.
Wow, that worked out pretty well, but maybe you could do even better. We'd love to see what sort of flying and gliding devices you can create, and don't be shy to share them with us on our social media channels. If you need some more inspiration, we've got a guide available on the Ontario Science Centre website. Have fun exploring the science of flight, and don't forget to ask, test, and repeat.